My experience has been over 45 plus years of teaching gospel nonviolence. And almost every place you go within the Christian church, or I've gone within the Christian church, people left, right, middle, conservative Christians, liberal Christians, radical Christians even, they don't take to Jesus' teachings of nonviolent love of friends and enemies rather easily. If I were to tell you, if I were to say to you, you don't have a right arm, and then you would say, well, this is, you know, say, it's crazy. I got a right arm. See, there's my right arm. I said, no, you don't have a right arm. After three or four times of my saying that, you just kind of dismiss me as kind of nutty, you know. But if I come into the church, or I come into a conference, a Christian conference, and say, Jesus' teachings are teachings of nonviolent love of friends and enemies. Wow. I mean, wow. People instantly get on edge. They don't want to touch it. They don't want to hear it. They immediately go to even ad hominem attacks. But the thing is, instantly when they hear that word nonviolence related to Jesus, it seems like antennas go up that say, stay away from this. Don't touch this. Don't get involved in it. I mean, I have had people, many people, just walk out as soon as they heard what the conference was going to be about, what I was going to talk about. There's like this, it's like there's an intuition, don't go in this direction, or you're going to find out things you don't want to find out, and you're going to find out that there is truth that you've got to come to grips with. Jesus' teachings of nonviolent love of friends and enemies in Christianity now, do have, a ripple effect that touches everything that we call Christian. Every institution that we know of that we call Christian under normal circumstances is riddled with justified violence of some kind or another. State, church, family, work, you name it. You name it. And so, and military, of course. And so, when I say to people that all laws are backed up by violence, all state laws are backed up by violence, people just get angry and say, no, the law is what's good, the law is, yeah, maybe that's what you think about it. But the fact of the matter is, every law is backed up by a sanction, or else it's not a law, it's just a platitude. Every law says, if you don't do this, you'll be punished. Or you do this and you'll be hurt. Some form of violence will be placed upon you. Some kind of pain will be thrown upon you. If you don't do it this way, that has been decided upon by a few people. And so also it is, not just with the state, but and not just the military. But think about the family. How many Christian families raise their children with threat and fear and violence? I will hurt you. That's not how they say it, but that's what they do. I will hurt you if you don't do it my way. How many? Oh, it's only spanking, or oh, it's only this or that, a slap, or it's only whatever, however the hurt is. Huh? But it will be, they run the family on that basis. I will hurt you. And therefore, at some level, there's violence, there's a fear factor going there. And of course, the church is hierarchical, which means holy domination, I guess. You know, it's a way of, with the Catholic Church anyway, and many others, and whether they are particularly hierarchical in the sense of the Catholic Church is or not, they are institutions set up where if you don't follow their rules, they hurt you, they throw you out, they excommunicate you, they remove you from your church, they take your church away from you. Recently, back in the city that I live in Brockton, Massachusetts, an Episcopal church, a conservative Episcopal church, refused to participate in inviting a homosexual priest to say Mass there and celebrate the Eucharist there, same with lesbian Episcopal priest. And they fought it, and they said no. And eventually, the bishop took the whole church away from them, the building and everything else. Didn't leave them a thing. So, the same is true in the Catholic Church and all the others. All I'm saying here is, Jesus' teachings of nonviolent love of friends and enemies has ripple effects in terms of the structure of the institutions that you can call Christian. If the institution is using violence or enmity for any purpose, then just because it has the name Christian on it does not make it a Christian institution. As a matter of fact, we can put it this way. Any job that cannot be done in a Christ-like way, that is, any job that cannot be done by loving as Christ loves, is a job that no Christian can take on. The most obvious example of that, I think, would be a brothel. Regardless of how many Christians lived in a brothel, it wouldn't make it a Christian phenomenon. I think also another example of that would be the military. Regardless of how many Christians were in the military, when you are in the military, you are not doing things in a Christ-like manner. Your task is to learn how to kill people and to kill them on command. And even if you do other things, your primary objective is kill people when ordered, and that's what you're trained for. Well, the question is, what other institutions are there? What other tasks are there? What other vocations and occupations are there that cannot be done in a Christ-like way? We certainly are not going to answer that here in detail, but what we can say is, when you're in a job, whether it be priest or bishop or head of government or head of the military or whatever the case may be, and you find that in that job, loving as Christ loved is impossible because of the requirements placed upon you, then if Jesus is your Lord, God, and Savior, the revealer of God's will and God's way to humanity for your salvation and the salvation of the world, you have no business in that job any more than you have a business working in a brothel, even as a secretary. So when the antennas go up and people hostily respond to even the slightest suggestion that Jesus' teachings are teachings of nonviolent love of friends and enemies, and that these teachings hold for discipleship and truly following his way, they sense it. They sense they're Christian, that they're living in a world, a Christian world, a church, a school, a family, a state, a job. They're living in a Christian world that is in utter contradiction of the teaching of Jesus. And they're not only living in it, but they're making a living off it. Would Jesus spend his life's time making weapons? And yet the arms industry is the biggest industry on the planet. And it's composed of first world people, huge percentage of which are baptized Christians called by Jesus to be something else and to do something else with their time, with their mind, and with their money until time is no more for them.